I want to go ahead and welcome everyone to Christ Church this morning and go ahead and encourage you guys to have a seat. And if you look in the front of the bulletin here, which I did notice that, you know, the Sunday that I decided to show up, a lot of you decided not to come. So that worries me a little bit. But if you look in the front of your bulletin, you'll see there's a verse from 1 Timothy and a quote. And these are could be helpful as you prepare for worship this morning. And so we'll take some time and be quiet and still and prepare our hearts for worship. Thanks. Please stand for the call to worship. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise.
For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, the heights of the mountains are also his. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land.
Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand.
Pray with me. Dear God, we thank you so much for gathering us here today. I pray that you would reveal the depths of your love for us today in this service and the heights of your glory, God, that we may understand better the sweetness of your grace and your mercy in our lives. God, some of us may desire to be elsewhere this morning. I pray for our hearts, that you would soften them, that you would stir up our affections for you, Lord God. God, you are mighty and worthy of all praise. Pray that our worship would conform to your will this morning. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. I know that some of y'all are very tired, but we're about to wake you up. Please sing with us.
Our King, make known the power of His grace, the beauty.
So we come to the time of confession in our worship service. I think it is always good, as I always say, to remember what this time is really about. It's not about checking boxes. It really is a time to rest in the grace and mercy of our God and in the work of Christ. I was thinking through this, and I really feel like this is a transformative act of worship in which we strip ourselves of any arraignment, right? And present ourselves morally naked before God. And that sounds uncomfortable, and it's kind of uncomfortable to say. But it's only uncomfortable right up to the moment that we recall the clothing of righteousness that Christ offers to believers. And so I would like to encourage you to not be proud at this point in our worship service. And if this causes you to lose heart in yourself and gain confidence in who Christ is and the work that he did for you on the cross. So hear this call to confession from Daniel chapter 9, verse 9 through 10. To the Lord our God belong mercy and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him and have not obeyed the voice of the Lord our God by walking in his laws. Yes, you guys can help read the call to confession. I'm sorry about that. So read the call to confession with me on page 3 in your bulletin. Gracious God, great is your faithfulness. You are truth. You are light. You are unchanging. However, we are unwise and fickle in all our ways. Our motives are always mixed and tangled up with selfishness and self-serving. We often doubt your love, your word, your power, and your wisdom. In our foolishness, we run from your truth down the path of disobedience and misery. In our blindness, we turn from your light and willingly rush into the darkness. In our anxiety and fear, we are often tossed back and forth by other people's opinions of us, rather than trusting you and valuing your unchanging love. O Lord, move us out of ourselves that we might abide in you. Amen. All right, now take some time for silent confession. Please stand with me as we read the assurance of the gospel. We know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. So we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Amen. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouths will declare your praise. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning,
is now, and ever shall be. Amen.
Hello again, everybody. So this is a brand new song. If y'all know it, great, y'all can sing along. But what we're gonna do is we're going to sing the verses up here, and y'all can join on the chorus if y'all don't know it. But if you do know it, please feel free to sing along with us.
Yes.
Very good. Thank you.
Please remain standing for the reading of God's Word. Our scripture reading today comes from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12 through 17. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me to his service. Though formerly I was a blasphemer, persecutor, and insolent opponent, but I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But I received mercy for this reason, that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display his perfect patience as an example to those who were to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. You can be seated. God, you are mighty, you are sovereign, and you care for us. And we need to be reminded of all that. I ask that you would use your word and your sacraments, the elements of this service, to prod us, if necessary, to a reliance and a trust in you and your ways that are mysterious to us. God, send your spirit to this place and fill your church, that we would be representative of your great redemption story to the community in Kerrville and beyond. God, we ask that you would do the same throughout our country and among all the nations. We read in your word about many broken, sinful people that you use for your service. Father, we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that you not abandon your efforts in the church or in us based on our own disruptive behavior or sinful actions, but that you would take what is broken and make it usable, and take what is ugly and make it beautiful. God, we pray that you would take sinful men and women like us and make us righteous for the glory and the fame of your name. We pray as you taught us, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I left my announcements on the chair over there. I don't think there's very many, but I'm going to grab them anyways. So really, two things. First, if you will continue, you guys are doing an awesome job, as a love for one another, wear your masks when you're not up here speaking, and also just try to keep your social distancing as much as possible. Again, as a love for one another, I will for sure, because I come from a camp where we've actually had kids this weekend, and so I don't want to get anybody sick. I'm not sick, but there you go. The other thing that I'd like to share is that if you'd like to leave an offering or a tithe, there's a basket up here and there's a basket at the back, so you can drop those there. If you're watching from home, welcome, good to talk to you guys. You can go online to our website and find a way to either mail in your tithe or pay online, I believe. So that's a really cool thing as well. So at this point, we'll do a social distancing passing of the peace, and I would encourage everybody to come and say hey, because I know that we love it when we're at home and you guys are waving at us. Mo always stands there and waves back at you. So, yeah, the peace of Christ be with you. Thank you.
I Thank you. Well, good morning. Maybe you don't recognize me. I haven't been up here in a few weeks. My name is Billy Crane. I'm the pastor here at Christ Church Kerrville. And I just want to thank all of y'all for your prayers for me and my family as we took some time off the past few weeks. It was a wonderful time for us to connect and enjoy being together and for me to just get a break. Like I said, before I went out of town, we've had a long year and a half of transitioning from our past job to this job, and it was good. It was a good time away, and I'm grateful to be back and to be worshiping with you. I love this song we just sang, Sing to Jesus, and really, the second verse, I'm going to reread it, actually summarizes our whole sermon. I almost feel like we should just read that and call it a day, but it says, Sing to Jesus, Lord of our shame. Lord of our sinful hearts, He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor His name. Sing of His faithfulness, pouring His love out unto death. We are looking at Psalm 51 today, which is a psalm of repentance by David, the king of Israel, after his adultery with Bathsheba and his murder of Uriah and just the whole big mess that he had made of his life because of his sin. And it would be so easy in those moments for him and for us to just plunge into despair. And he certainly had great grief and sorrow for his sin and for what he had done in mistreating others and in rebelling against God. And yet in the psalm, what we see is one who sees the depths of their sin can find hope and grace and mercy in Christ Jesus. And before I went out of town, we looked at the first half of this psalm. Him looking at the depths of his heart and pleading for God's mercy and God meeting him there. And in this passage today, we're going to be focusing on the last part, which actually looks at his response to God's grace and mercy in his life. So we're going to be focusing on verses 13 through 19, but I'm going to read the whole psalm for the sake of context. So Psalm 51, this is the word of the Lord. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity. And in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings, in whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar. The grass withers and the flowers fade, but the word of our Lord lasts forever. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this word that speaks truth to the brokenness in our lives and our failings and speaks hope as well. We pray that you would give us grace to see what you would have here for us today. In your name we pray. Amen. I want you to think about and imagine, what if someone did something that was absolutely an amazing, overly abundant, generous act for you? And maybe some of you have experienced that. I know I have. I want you to imagine that you were in some trouble or distress, And a person came forward to meet that need in a way that exceeded your greatest expectations. That you were having car trouble and someone shows up and just buys you a new car. You're having difficulty paying some of your bills and a person shows up and pays off your mortgage. You are having health problems and you need a new kidney and someone shows up and says, hey, I'll give you one of mine. And they do, and they give you life. How do you respond to something like that? Thankfulness, right? You would think we'd have a thankful heart. And yet at the same time, if you're like me, at times when someone does something that's extravagantly gracious, my response is to think, oh man, maybe I owe them something. Maybe I have to earn something. Maybe I have to prove to them just how grateful I am, or even that I was worthy of that gift. And yet, that's not the way we're meant to respond to overwhelming graciousness. And we see this throughout the scriptures, but even in this passage here, because God has given greatly to us. He has been overly generous to us and poured out his mercy upon us. In fact, listen to what it says. I'm going to go back and read a little bit from 7 through 12, where it says that it's looking at his own sin and that he deserves punishment. And he says, Lord, cleanse me. And all these things that he's asking, you've got to understand that God actually did for him and does for anyone who cries out to him for mercy. So he has cleansed us. He has washed us from our sins and made us whiter than snow. He is bringing joy to us even when we have had broken bones and crushed hearts. The Lord has hidden his face from our sins and blotted out our iniquities. Despite what we feel and what we are experiencing, the Lord moves in and creates in us a clean heart and renews a right spirit within us. He doesn't cast us from his presence or take his Holy Spirit from us, even though that's what we deserve, but restores to us the joy of our salvation. The Lord gives generously to us, and the reality is he doesn't want our good deeds to prove something to him. What he wants is our hearts. And we see this in verse 17, where he says, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. God wants our hearts because he knows that if he has our hearts, he has everything else. It reminds me of the story of Zacchaeus in Luke chapter 19, where Zacchaeus is the chief tax collector in the town of Jericho, and he is despised and hated because in his greed he steals from people. Because money is what controls his heart. And he meets Jesus, and Jesus offers him forgiveness and welcomes him into his family. And his response to Jesus is, on this day, I'm going to give half of my possessions away to the poor. And the point isn't that if Jesus forgives you, you should give half of your stuff away. That's not the point. The point is that there is now a new controlling power in his life. There's something that has gotten control of his heart that's bigger than money, and it's Jesus. And therefore, he lives and moves forward with his life with a heart impacted by the grace of God because of the forgiveness he has received and light of the sins that he has committed. God has shown him grace, not because he did something great, but because he was a sinner who didn't deserve grace, and it was given to him generously. And there's a lot of things that we could talk about today as we look at David's psalm and look at how we're called to respond to God's overwhelming generosity and kindness to us. But I want to look at two things today. There's two responses that when God gets a hold of our hearts, it will lead us to worship him and to witness for him. To worship him and to witness for him. And in verse 14, as we look at the first point, that it leads to worship. And I'm going to just talk briefly about the worship, but just really talk more about why we worship him. There's an amazing feeling of wonder in these verses. In verse 14, he describes God as the God of his salvation, the one who rescues him from danger and saves him. In verse 14, again, he says, I will sing of your righteousness. I will sing and the music of my heart and the lips and of my lips will be of your glory and greatness. In verse 15, he says, O Lord, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise. That in light of what we see, we cannot help but worship and praise the Lord with our words, in our hearts, and with our lives. And, you know, just to reflect on that, because really, I can tell you to do this, But really, it flows out of really acknowledging, seeing, experiencing, remembering what God has done for you. In verse 14, David says, deliver me from blood guiltiness. He's recalling his murder. He is guilty of spilling somebody's blood. Can you believe that? That God could enter in and forgive this murderer? And as we've talked about in our Life of David series, this was not a just quick impulse, involuntary manslaughter. No, this was a calculated, cold-blooded murder. And God steps into this situation and forgives him of the worst of what he has done. And that just doesn't apply to David. It applies to all of us. The beginning of this passage, which this is a psalm not just about David or for David, it's for all of us. It reminds us of our transgressions, which is our breaking of God's rules. It reminds us of our iniquity, which is just our moral failure. It reminds us of our sin, which is doing what God tells us not to do and not doing what God tells us to do. And then it drives it all back to our hearts and says the problem is we have a heart that's bent against God. That we have a heart that puts other things on the altar of our life and says we want to worship that, whether it's money or success or pleasure or just ourselves or whatever we want. And that is the mindset, the makeup, the bent, the demeanor of our heart is that's what we're drawn to. And I just want to ask you, how would you respond to a person like that in your life? How would you respond to someone who never listens to you, who doesn't do what you tell them to do, and is constantly just ignoring you and just being rude to you? You'd say, I think we need to end this relationship, right? I don't think that I want to be around a person like that. I remember in high school, I had a friend that told me once, he said, if someone ever lies to me, I'm done with them. You get one chance on that one, right? Thank goodness God doesn't give us just one chance. But instead, he shows incredible grace and mercy in light of our sin. In light of the ways in which we deserve to be condemned, he pours out his mercy and grace upon us. And it reminds me and takes me to the story of the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, who we think of as the great missionary apostle of the New Testament, who took the gospel to the far corners of the known world at that time, in a sense, by taking it all the way to Rome from Jerusalem. And yet, when you read the story of the scriptures, who is Paul when we first meet him? Paul is the first great enemy of the church. He is someone who went about trying to destroy the church. In fact, in the passage that we read for one of our scripture readings today, and I'm going to read part of it again, in 1 Timothy 1, verse 13, he says, I'm a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a violent man. I'm a blasphemer. I say lies about God. He was saying Jesus wasn't Lord. And he was going around trying to make sure you knew that. He was a persecutor of the church. He went about persecuting and throwing in jail people who followed Jesus. And he was a violent man. And that's referring to the fact that he had people mistreated or even killed or approved of those who did because they followed Jesus. This is who he was, a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a violent man, a murderer. And God enters in and rescues him. Listen to this passage. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. And what he's saying is, I wasn't shown mercy because I was a pretty good person and God thought I was a workable project. He wasn't saying I was doing some pretty good things. He was saying I was lost. I was really, really lost. And God saw me and he poured out his mercy upon me. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I'm the worst. And when you hear that and you realize that's me, the response is, Lord, thank you. Thank you that you would have mercy on a sinner like me. And one of the ways that he highlights this in this passage, in this verse 14, he says, I will sing, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. And as I was reading through this passage, I just kind of got stuck there, because if I had been doing really bad things and someone had been gracious to me and not punishing me as they should, I would be singing of their mercy. I would be singing of their kindness. I would be singing of their love. Why would I sing of their righteousness? Because by doing that, what I'm pointing out is all the things that make them so great and all the things that make me so awful. And that's the point. It's pointing out the fact that God is amazing. Can you believe that he would associate with people like us? It reminds me of a quote from the first Star Wars, the original, A New Hope, where there's this scene where Luke and Han Solo are sitting in the Millennium Falcon and Princess Leia has just left the room, and Han Solo kind of leans over to Luke and goes, "So what do you think? What do you think, a princess and a guy like me?" And Luke goes, "No, no way. There's no hope for you. Hey, what do you think? The Lord, the righteous God, holy God of the universe, and a guy like me? No, there is no hope for you. There is no way that that relationship works." And yet, because God is gracious and merciful and kind, he says, "Come in. I welcome you in. I forgive you." You know, we are rebels who spit in the face of God and say, "Get out of my way." And yet he says, "I invite you to be a part of my family. I offer you forgiveness." I love 1 John 3:1, and when I read it, there's a sense of wonder and awe in this. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. And what he's saying is, can you believe this? Can you believe how amazing the grace of God is? And it leads us to worship. Worship in our hearts, worship in our words, worship in our singing, and worship in our lives. And really, we could spend a whole nother sermon on verses 16 and 17. I'm going to. I actually wrote a note that said we're going to have a whole sermon on verses 16 and 17. Not next week, but at some point. But in verse 16 and 17, it says, "For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You do not take, you are not pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." And the reality is, the people of this time were told to bring sacrifices to God. So why is David criticizing people bringing sacrifices? And the reason is because he is speaking against the idea of people just kind of doing their religious duty and being done with God. I'm going to go do the things he told me to do. I'm going to show up to church. I maybe go to Bible study, give a little money to the church or to a good cause. And then I'm going to go about and do my own thing. He says, no, that's not what God wants. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. And the reason why that's so powerful is because you can't put that on the shelf. You take that everywhere, and it impacts everything that you do. And therefore, when we see what we deserve and what God has given us, it should humble us. And pray that the Lord would help you to see that daily. Daily, Lord, I need to be reminded of the grace that God has poured out upon me, has lavished on me, that I do not deserve. You are amazing. What would you have from me? I owe him everything because he's given me everything. That is the mercy of God. That is the wonder of forgiveness. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom you and me are the worst ones that we know. Right? I am the worst sinner that I know. Praise the Lord for the mercy of Jesus Christ. And I want to just give you a little assignment for this week, a little action. All right? One is, I want you to take a moment, if you're a Christian, and to consider what the Lord has rescued you from. What is the great shame or guilt or failure of your life? The thing that you look at and go, who could love me because of that? It might be something in the past. It might be an ongoing struggle. And I want you to write that down. I want you to lay it before the Lord. And I want you to speak this truth, to know that Jesus Christ died for that sin. That sin has been forgiven. That ongoing struggle has been forgiven. And it will be because of the mercy and the grace of God. And I don't know if that will give you, I don't know where that will take you, but I pray that it will bring you comfort and joy. But also, if it's not, if it's still something that you're struggling with, pray that the Lord would bring you comfort and joy. And to speak this truth into your life. And to ask his Holy Spirit to minister to you. Because he wants you to experience the freedom and joy that his forgiveness gives you. And if you're not a believer, if you're not someone who is a follower of Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to do the same thing. What is it that you think makes you unacceptable to yourself, to the world, to the people that you most care about? What is it? What is it that if people knew, they wouldn't love you, they wouldn't accept you, they would reject you? And I'm telling you, you put that on the table, and I want you to ask the Lord to meet you there. Say, Lord, I don't know you, but if you can forgive a sinner like me, will you make that clear to me through your word, through your spirit, through the people who I come into contact with? Convince me that you are that big, because I promise you he is. God's mercy and grace leads us to worship. It is so good. Second, when God has gotten a hold of us, when his grace has gotten a hold of us, it also leads us to witness to others. In verse 13, it says, "Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you." And the reality is when someone has done something amazing for you, you cannot help but share it with others. And in this grace that God has shown to us, when we have experienced this forgiveness and grace, it moves us out to share this good news with other people. I mean, you know this reality. When something good or great or awesome has happened, you want to let people know. I mean, we do it with small things and silly things. I walked into an AutoZone a few years ago, and they had high-quality windshield wipers on sale. You know what I did? I started calling people, right? That's good news. That's nothing compared to the grace of God, right? I am making known the glories of AutoZone. Why am I not doing that as well with the glories and the greatness of God's grace? I want to, and I need to let other people know. And that's a picture a picture of what is happening in this passage is David is saying, as I experience your forgiveness and grace, I cannot help but share with others what God has done for me. I will teach others your way, other transgressors, people who know you that are struggling, people who don't know you who are struggling, that they might hear what you have done in my life and come back to you. And there's a real sense in one thing that we could do right now is kind of have a little evangelism seminar, and that's very appropriate. I could talk to you about how to share your faith. And we will do that from this pulpit from time to time, and we will do that in Sunday school classes or in special seminars. But what I see in this passage as David shows the depths of his own sin is what he's calling us to do is to be real about who we are and what God has done in our life. He wants us to stand before the world and be honest about our own failings and say, Jesus met me here in this dark place, in this great shame. You know, there are people out there looking for hope. There are people out there who are suffering, and some of them think maybe Jesus is the answer, and they come and they look into the doors of the church and they say, I don't know. These people are perfect. They have it all together. None of them seem to struggle. They think, would they ever accept a person like me? And they walk away, and they don't walk in the door. My friends, people need to know what you and I have been saved and rescued from. The story from the song Amazing Grace really should be true of all of us. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. If you can't tell that story, you need to dig a little deeper, all right? Because that's what's in our heart. We know that there are things in here that are just not right, and yet the Lord meets us and forgives us of those things. And I'm not saying you need to share the worst of yourself with every single person, but there are times when it's appropriate, when you see someone struggling or down or believing the lie that they're unforgivable, when you need to step up and say, hey, let me tell you about how the Lord met me. You need to know what the Lord has forgiven me from. And I'm not just talking about the things in the past, when before you were a Christian, okay? That's very true. Some of you have amazing stories of rescue, of how God went and got and saved you. And as you feel appropriate, as you feel it is appropriate, you should share that story with others. But there are stories of God's forgiveness and rescue in our lives every single day. Even for you people like me that are trying every day to follow Jesus, right? I can see in my own heart the greed and the lack of faith and the bad temper and the anger and everything else. And the reality is, people need to know what is going on. I mean, could anyone ever believe that you ever were being so, you had ever so lost your temper that you made one of your children cry because you were being such a mean person? I have. I've made one of my kids cry. You want to talk about that? You want to talk about the depth of the sin that says to a 45-year-old man that he can't control himself? We can talk about that. Have you ever been so given to your addictions to food or alcohol or drug or pleasure that it caused you to disregard the needs of someone you cared about or even put them in danger? We can talk about that. I can show you points in my life where I have cared more about what I'm about to eat than anybody else in the world. Shame on me. But you know what? God meets me in that grace. And there's forgiveness for someone like that. Can you communicate to someone the fact that maybe monthly or weekly or daily you struggle with trusting the Lord, that He's going to provide for you, that He's going to meet your needs? Man, I can count on some times recently where I thought, God, are you going to show up? Where are you? I think I'm all alone here. And I say, I'm going to have to do it by myself. You know what that's called? It's called faithlessness. That's called not believing the truth that the Lord communicates to us. Doubting Him in a way that says, you're not good because you're not going to care for and meet my needs. That's what the Israelites are condemned for over and over again in the Old Testament, and it's in my heart. Thank God for Jesus. And people in this church, we need each other. Like you said, we don't need to be sharing everything with everybody, but there's times we need to say, like, man, I struggle too. Let me tell you the ways of the Lord, which is He is merciful and gracious with someone like you. Someone should be able to, I really long for people to say, you know what, I can be forgiven. Because if God could forgive a person like Billy, He can forgive me too. That's the story. That's part of the story that David is trying to communicate here with us. And I love this. I love this belief. I love this truth. And just to finish up that passage from 1 Timothy, listen to how Paul talks about his life after this. Starting again at verse 15, he says, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I'm the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display His unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on Him and receive eternal life. What he's saying is, I'm an example of God's grace. I'm actually a trophy. Hey, you guys want to see what God can do? On his trophy shelf is Paul the Apostle. You see this guy? Blasphemer, violent man, persecutor. Saved him. You don't think I can handle you? Handle that guy. And that's the way it's supposed to be with us. People are supposed to go, man, God did an amazing work in Billy's life. There's hope for me. I'm going to seek out this God. That's part of the means by which God draws people to Himself, is that those who have experienced that grace cannot help but talk about it. And I would love to talk with you about that more. I understand it's difficult to be vulnerable in those ways, and at times it can be dangerous. It really can. People can use those things against you. But what I know is what it means is, I know that it means I'm not supposed to shut myself off from ever communicating the grace that God has shown to me, to everyone. And so I'd love to talk with you about that if that intimidates you and scares you. But I think that's part of the reality, is that when our lives have been captured by the grace of God, when we see how the Lord has met us in the depths of our sin and has overwhelmingly shown us mercy and grace, that the response is our worship and our witness. And that's, I hope that will be more and more the truth and reality of my life, because it's still something that I'm ongoing, growing in, and learning about and experiencing every day. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we rejoice in You that You have a trophy case with us on it. And it's called Your House, because in your house are many rooms, and you have prepared a place for us. And we will be with you for eternity. Thank you for the grace and the mercy of God. You are good and kind to undeserving and wretched people, Lord. We thank you for the grace of God and that you gave us Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. We now come to the Lord's Supper. And this is a meal for those who see the depths of their sin and see that outside of themselves there is no hope, and yet also see that there is a great Savior who has drawn near and rescued them, and that Jesus Christ is the one in whom their hope is. If that is you, if you are a person who have put your hope in Christ Jesus as both your Savior and Lord, we welcome you to this table. This is a meal for you, and we pray you will come and be strengthened by it. If that's not where you are, if you have not come to the place where you recognize Jesus Christ as both Savior and Lord, and you have not come to the place where you have seen your need for him, or maybe you see your need but you haven't realized that Jesus is the one who can meet that need, we are so grateful that you're here, and we want to let you know that this is a good place for you to be, to ask questions and to learn more about who Christ is. But we ask that before you come to this meal, before you come to this table, that you come to Christ first. And if you'd like to talk about that, if you'd like to talk about how you may draw near to the Lord, please come and see me. Please come and talk to me. I would love to talk with you about it. Or if you feel uncomfortable talking to me, I would love to help find someone who you would feel comfortable talking to about. As we look at the bread and wine, which represents the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus Christ, it reminds us of the lengths to which God would go to rescue us, that he would send his own beloved son to be broken, crushed, and killed so that we might be children of God. That's good news. Please join me here. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy Father, creator of heaven and earth, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give thanks and praise to your glorious name. Amen. The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Amen. And as you come forward, we ask that kind of go by sections, and if you'll go kind of go to the inside aisle and then come back around, and then here go to the inside aisle and come back around. And for this one, just go to the inside aisle and come back around. That would be great. So please come forward as you feel led. We'll start with Adam here. The body of Christ broken for you. Take and eat. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Please stand and join me in this prayer of thanksgiving. Most gracious God, we praise you for what you have given
and for what you have promised us here. You have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. You have fed us with the bread of life and renewed us for your service. Now we give ourselves to you, and we ask that our daily living may be part of your kingdom, and that our love may be your love, reaching out into the life of the world. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please join in singing with us one more time today.
Thank you so much for being here today and joining us for worship. Please receive this benediction from 1 Timothy chapter 1. To the King of ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.